Hi, welcome to another session of the Potter's Roundtable from Washington Street Studios. I'm Phil Burnberg. Today we're going to be continuing our discussion of tips for successful glazing. This is going to be part three. In part one, we talked about glaze compositions and preparation and mixing of the glazes. In part two, we talked about existing glazes and surface preparation. Originally, I was going to include application as part of that discussion, but we realized the tape was coming a little long, so we cut it off just those two. So today we'll be talking about application, cleanup, and finishing of the glaze, and finally a little bit about firing, although there will be in the future, there'll be a whole section where we talk about firing of glazes. So there'll just be a couple of comments here.
Welcome to the Potter's Roundtable, a monthly podcast where we share our passion for the ceramic arts and a collection of topics specific to potters. Remember to subscribe so you don't miss a single episode. Enjoy the show.
So, glaze application. Well, glazes, as you probably are aware, can be applied by a variety of methods: dipping and pouring, brushing the glazes on, spraying the glazes with a spray gun or an airbrush, and including even things like spattering and splashing and literally throwing the glaze at the pot for some abstract effects. And one of the points related to this, the fact that in spite of the fact that you may have a glaze recipe, there are certain adjustments you might want to make to the recipe depending on how you're going to do the application. So for example, if you're dipping a pot, as we talked about in the last session, you really, if possible, you want the glaze to be in the flocculated condition so that you can avoid runs and drips and so that the water will be absorbed quickly into the pot through the flocculated glaze. So you want to make sure that the glaze is flocculated. Another advantage of flocculation in that case is that if there are coarser particles in the glaze, they will be suspended in the glaze. They won't tend to settle out at the bottom. So they really aren't a problem if the glaze is well flocculated. If you're spraying the glaze, one of the things you're probably going to want to do is you're probably going to want to screen it with a much finer sieve than you would for dipping or pouring, just to avoid any little chunks and lumps that could plug up a very small nozzle orifice. So even though you've used the glaze before for dipping, if you decide to spray it, you might want to run it again through a finer sieve. If you're brushing the glaze, if the glaze is not intended for brushing, such as a commercial glaze that you buy, you know, pre-made, you're probably going to want to add some kind of a brushing aid to the glaze. If you've ever tried to take a glaze that you normally use for dipping and pouring and brush it on a pot, you notice you dip the brush into it and you touch it to the pot and you go, "Ert!" Because the minute the brush touches the pot, it sucks all the water out of it, and then the glaze won't flow. You can't brush the glaze. So you need to add something to that glaze to make it so that the water doesn't come out so quickly and it has more of a creamy, smooth, like latex paint-like consistency. And what you generally add is some sort of a gum. What's called a gum is basically sap from it's a naturally occurring sap from some kind of a plant, either a bush or a shrub in general. There are other kinds, but there are lots of different kinds of these organic gums. And what they do is they hold water and prevent the water from being absorbed quite so quickly. The one that I recommend is artificial maple syrup. I'm not pushing this particular brand, but this is the cheapest kind of maple syrup that you can get. It's on the bottom shelf. You have to lie on the floor in the grocery store to find it, because as you know, in grocery stores, they put the most expensive products at eye level. Well, this has absolutely no natural ingredients in it. It's artificial color, artificial flavor, artificially sweetened. But the great thing is that one of the major ingredients is cellulose gum, which is the exact ingredient that you want to use for adding to a glaze to make it brushable. In fact, when you buy a commercial pre-made glaze, typically, more likely they're low-fire glazes, but also cone six, or you buy an underglaze, they contain cellulose gum. So what I do when I go to the grocery store is I look for the maple syrup, and which is mostly cellulose gum. And if you read the ingredients, you know, the way normally food ingredients are listed is they're listed in decreasing order or decreasing amount. So the first ingredient on the ingredient list is the most. So if you look at one of these inexpensive maple syrups, the first ingredient is water. The second one is typically sorbitol, an artificial sweetener. And the third one is, ta-da, cellulose gum, which is exactly what we want. The advantage of using this instead of, you can buy cellulose gum powder, by the way, and make up your own solution. But this will last a lifetime. And I'll explain in a minute. But the nice thing is also, this comes with a preservative built in with it. So you can keep this on your shelf for the rest of your life and it won't go bad and it won't rot. So it's very useful. So typically, what I'll do, for example, if I want to apply a glaze that normally isn't meant for brushing, I'll take a small quantity of the glaze in a small container, maybe a pint container, and I'll add a little bit of this. And by a little bit, I mean at the most, maybe in a pint of glaze, at the most a teaspoon or less of this. And as you stir it in, you'll see the glaze become creamier and thicker and almost more pudding-like. But what it does is it holds the water, and all of a sudden it turns the glaze that isn't brushable into something that just flows like latex paint. It works great. Now you don't want to take, once you've added this to the glaze, you don't want to take any leftover glaze and dump it back in the regular bucket, because it will make it work less well for dipping and pouring. This is just for brushing. But you want to add some kind of a gum, and this is the easiest form to get it. Instead of buying powder, making up your own solution, and the solution will go bad, it won't stay on, is just buy something like this. And just so look at the ingredient list and see if it has, whether it has some kind of artificial gum in it. And in general, this is also, you'll find it in salad dressings and a lot of other food products, but this is the simplest because it's basically water and gum and sweetener and a little bit of color. Nothing that will interfere with the way the glaze works. Finally, if you're splashing a glaze on and you're literally throwing the glaze or spattering it on, you're probably also going to want the glaze to be flocculated, because when the glaze is hitting the pot, you want the water to be absorbed quickly so that it stays put. So that if you're trying to produce a particular spray pattern or spatter pattern, you don't want it to run and drip. So you probably also want to make sure that the glaze is flocculated to avoid running. As you probably are aware already, in general, when you're glazing forms, what are called closed forms, like cups, mugs, and bowls and things, the general procedure is to glaze the inside first by pouring the glaze into the container and then rotating the glaze and pouring it out and then glazing the outside. If you are dipping a pot completely in the glaze, when you're removing the pot from the glaze, don't just hold it and let it drain in one spot. Slowly rotate the pot so that the last little bit of glaze can flow off the lip and doesn't stay in one place. That way you won't end up with a thickened line where the glaze has come off. You'll spread the drip around over the rim. So I slowly rotate it, let the last little bit of glaze come off until it stops dripping. One of the things I found that's really useful for when I'm pouring a glaze, for instance, as I mentioned, like let's say you pour the glaze into the container, you pour it out, now you have to glaze the bottom, is a setup like this, where I'll have a catch basin, and I'll want to, if I don't want to hold the pot in my hand, let's say it's a larger form, I can put a support across the pot, the top of the basin, to hold the pot and then pour the glaze over it. And one of the things that I found works very well are basically angle irons. In this case, they're made out of aluminum, but they're angle iron supports. And the nice thing about these features is they're strong, they won't bend, but they also have a very small point of contact with the pot. So that I found that if you used wooden slats, you tend to get, because the wood is somewhat absorbent, you tend to get glaze that collects around the contact point. And if that happens to be on a surface that's going to remain glazed, you can end up with like little extra lumps of glaze. So by having these pointed like this, you end up with very little glaze adhering to the pot, and the glaze can easily drain off the supports. I don't get extra glaze accumulating on the pot. And these you can get, I get these at a local hardware store. And this is just aluminum angle supports. One of the recommendations also I have for glazing is that if you have a complicated shape, don't try to glaze the whole pot necessarily by dipping the pot all at once. Dip it or glaze it in sections. I've also done this for pots where I have a glaze that, let's say, is very sensitive to overlaps. And a classic example of that is cone 10 celadon glazes, true celadons. They tend to be very sensitive to thickness variations. One of the reasons why you use them, for example, is to get this beautiful transparent or translucent green, but they're very sensitive to thickness variations, and you see every little defect in terms of overlaps and spots and drips and things, so that if you're glazing a large piece that's awkward to glaze, you don't want glaze dripping over previously glazed areas. So what I recommend is glaze it in parts, and even, let's say, even just a simple large cylinder form, let's say you want to dip the outside, but it's too large to dip at once. Instead of just dipping one end and turning it over and dipping it, I'll dip half of it, and then I'll wax the top part of the glazed portion and leave just a tiny little bit, I mean a millimeter or less, a 16th of an inch or less of glaze that isn't waxed, and wax the rest of it. And then when I dip it, I don't have to worry about lining up the glaze exactly with my previous line, and I've left just enough glaze from the first part to continue with the second part, but not enough so that I'll get a noticeable line. So I really recommend, and again, this is where glazing requires some patience and it requires some time, and I've done pots that are complicated where I might break the pot down into three or four parts and glaze them in parts. So I'll glaze part of it, let it dry, put some wax on, let the wax dry, glaze the second part, let it dry, put the wax on, let it dry. So it takes time and it takes patience, but you get much better results than producing a piece with glaze runs and drips that are flowing all over the surface of the pot. On the other hand, if you're doing intentional overlaps, I really recommend don't let the first glaze dry completely before you apply the second glaze. One of the problems that can happen is if you do that, if the first glaze has completely dried and now you're going to apply a second glaze over all of it or part of it, when the water from the second glaze soaks into the first glaze, it can loosen the bond to the surface and result in crawling later on when you fire it. So it won't show up. When you finish doing the overlap, you might look like you've done a very nice glaze application, and then when you fire it, the overlapped area, or maybe the whole thing, runs, and that's because the water has loosened the bond. This is, again, going back to what we talked about last time about the overlaps, where if you loosen the bond, it can result in crawling. It doesn't have to, but it's more likely to crawl. So what I usually do is I wait for the first glaze to get to the point where I can touch it with my fingers and handle it, but it's not totally dry, and then I'll put on the second glaze. What that also does is that avoids an overly thick application of the second glaze, which again can cause running. So by the fact that the first glaze is a little damp in the area of the overlap, you don't get as much of the second glaze on that, so you don't get an excessive thick buildup of glaze in that area. One of the things to also keep in mind when you are overlapping glazes is, in a sense, you're creating a new glaze. Where the two glazes overlap, you're combining the ingredients of the two different glazes, and you've essentially created a third recipe. And even though the two separate glazes maybe don't run by themselves, by mixing them or creating this overlap area, you may be creating a new composition that now will run. So there's no guarantee that when you overlap two glazes that they won't run, even if they don't run separately. Another comment as far as clear glazes. In general, there are clear glazes can be, if they're too thick, can be a little on the cloudy or milky side. This is especially true with 06 and cone 6 glazes. Not so much with cone 10, but especially cone 06 earthenware or cone 6 glazes. If they're too thick, they can be milky. So keep in mind, keep the application thinner. One of the reason why they tend to be milky is a lot of them contain borates, like Gerstle borate or boron containing frits in the recipe, and they tend to produce this cloudiness when the glaze gets thick. So to avoid that, keep the application of the clear glazes thin for 06 or cone 6 glazes. As far as spraying glazes, when you're spraying a glaze onto a pot, you actually need to, and you're looking at the layer that you're applying, the layer of sprayed glaze actually needs to be a little thicker than what you might be normally used to seeing if you're dipping or pouring the pot. And the reason why is this, is because when you're spraying the glaze, you're actually getting an accumulation of, instead of producing a solid layer of glaze like this, that you get when you dip or pour, when you're spraying a glaze, you actually get a buildup of little sort of dried droplets. So the layer of sprayed glaze is actually not as dense and as solid as when you dip in or pour it. So to get the same amount of glaze, the sprayed glaze layer in general, not all the time, but in general, needs to actually look to be a little thicker than it would normally be because of it has a lot of, basically a lot of holes in it. And finally, when there's a precaution as far as glazing thin-walled pots, and this is the precaution to prevent crawling. It's fairly common for glazes on thin-walled pots to crawl for a reason related to something we've already talked about. If you have a thin-walled pot and you dip it in a glaze, the water is absorbed into the pot, and it can very quickly completely saturate the wall of the pot. So the water moves in from both sides of the wall, reaches the center, and there's no dried clay left. At that point, the clay stops absorbing water. There's no more that sort of suction, if you want to call it that, that's caused by the surface tension pulling the glaze in. And what happens is, when that happens is, the glaze on the surface is not as tightly bound to the surface. It's not being pulled onto the surface as much. And what happens is, so I get a looser layer of glaze that can lead to crawling. So if you have very thin-walled pots, you have to be careful not to keep them in the glaze too long if you're dipping them. So you either want to do a quick dip, or you might want to brush on the glaze or spray the glaze on so that you can build it up in layers, but you don't saturate the glaze. The last thing you can do is, this is a case where actually deflocculated glazes work better, because deflocculated glazes generally can contain less water and still have the same fluidity. So I can brush them on and I'm not saturating the wall with the glaze. But this is fairly common. I've seen this a lot, for example, and at any temperature, when you're applying the glaze, if you saturate the wall, then the glaze layer is not as tightly bound to it, and it can move when you fire it, and that can lead to crawling.
We hope you're enjoying the show. Please take a moment to leave a 5-star review on your podcast platform of choice. It really helps new listeners find the show. Don't forget to subscribe to receive updates as new episodes are released. And if you'd like to support the video and podcast production of the Potter's Roundtable, become a patron. Go to patreon.com and search for the Potter's Roundtable. Your support will help us achieve our goal of creating a digital library spanning the ceramic arts for use by educators and artists alike. Thank you for your support. Now let's get back to the show.
Okay, so those are all the comments we had as far as glaze application. Now let's talk a little bit about the next topic, glaze cleanup and touch-up or finishing. Cleanup and finishing. So this is after the glaze has dried, and now you're getting ready, you're doing the final sort of completing the pot before you actually get it ready to fire it. This is a case, again, where using some kind of the syrup can be very useful. You might have places on the pots where maybe you have marks where you maybe chipped the glaze off a little bit, or you didn't get complete coverage, and it's fairly common to have to want to go back and just touch up little spots on the glaze. And again, if you try to brush on a dipping glaze, you usually end up with thick blobs or lumps, and you don't get a nice little, just a little coverage in the area you're trying to touch up. So again, take a little bit of the glaze, add maybe a tablespoon of glaze, and add one drop of syrup to it, and that will make the glaze much more brushable, and you can do a very nice refined touch-up job instead of getting a lump there. When you do have lumps and blobs on the surface or marks on the surface, and a classic example is if you use dipping tongs when you're glazing your pieces, you usually end up with a little sort of circular ring or an accumulation of glaze with a tong, with a little dimple in the middle, where the tong was touching the pot, and you want to smooth those over. The easiest way to get rid of those is don't touch them up. When the glaze is completely dry, just take your finger and very lightly rub over the dried glaze, and you can fill in that little depression and smooth it out just with your finger. But in order for this to work properly, the glaze has to be completely dry. If you don't let it dry, then the glaze will just kind of smear. It won't smooth out very nicely with your finger. One of the other tricks I've used sometimes, if I have dried glazes, that sometimes the glaze can be really fragile, so much, especially if it's sprayed, so that when you touch it, it's actually coming, you can't even pick it up to handle it or load it or to clean the bottom. You pick it up and it's coming off on your fingers, and you see that when you touch the pot, you're actually making marks on the surface of the glaze that can show up. So one trick I found is very useful is after the glaze has dried, I give it a coating of spray starch. So I'll take a can of spray starch and spray it and give it a coating. And what that does is it hardens the glaze surface now that it becomes handleable. And the starch will just burn off very early in the firing. It won't hurt anything. But now I can handle the pot to load it into the kiln or to clean off the bottom if I have to. Don't forget to clean off glaze droplets in any area where you've used a wax resist. Just because you've used a wax resist doesn't mean that there might not be a little film or a couple of little droplets of glaze on it. The wax saves you a lot of trouble in terms of removing whole areas, cleaning them for glaze, but there still can be little droplets, and sometimes it's hard because of the color of the glaze. It's hard to see the glaze because the wax sometimes comes out sort of tan, and you might have the dry glaze might be kind of tan, but I always make it a point of thoroughly sponging any waxed areas to make sure that I don't have any little droplets of glaze that I've left on the surface. Okay, glaze firing. We're going to talk more about this later on when we'll have a whole section where we talk about firing. We will be talking about glaze defects, but just a couple of general comments. First of all, when you're doing a glaze firing, use cones, pyrometric cones. Don't depend on temperature. Don't depend on the temperature that the electronic controller says or anything else, because the glazes and the clay are not maturing based on temperature alone. They're maturing based on a combination of temperature and time. And the cones are designed to respond. The cones are made of little clay, they're clay bodies, basically, of different compositions. And so they respond to the firing the same way your pots do. It takes time for the clay to mature. It takes time for the glaze to mature and become the finished product. So it's much better to use cones for firing than just relying on temperature. Also, learn your kiln. Learn where in your kiln you might have hot spots or cold spots in the kiln, or if you're doing an atmospheric kiln, learn where you have better or poorer reduction. And the idea is, then you can, instead of trying to necessarily fight with those conditions, which sometimes you can't change, you can just put certain glazes in certain parts of the kiln and take advantage of those conditions in the kiln. So if you have a kiln, for example, that tends to fire a little cooler on the bottom, there might be, and let's say you're doing cone 6 firing, as I mentioned earlier, there are some cone 6 glazes that actually might work better at cone 5.5 or cone 5. So you can put those glazes on the bottom in that cooler spot and then put other glazes in other parts of the kiln. So you can take advantage and use those conditions. Another thing I really recommend for both bisque firing and glaze firing is using a hold at the end of the firing. For example, for cone 6 firing, instead of going directly to cone 6, what we do at the studio here at Washington Street Studios is we go to cone 5, and then I add a 25-minute hold at the end of the cone 5. And this, what this does is it helps even out the temperatures. Even though I know the kiln that I'm using generally gives me very uniform temperatures, I have found I get much better results by adding this hold at the end. And a 25-minute, at cone 6 or cone 5 in that range, a 25-minute hold essentially adds one cone to the firing. So I can put in a cone 6, an actual cone, bring the kiln to cone 5, hold it for 25 minutes, and the number 6 cone will bend. Because cones respond to temperature and time, the hold, 25-minute hold, essentially increases the firing by one cone. So I found I get much better results that way. Another thing, especially in electric kilns, to avoid overfiring is, if you can, avoid very rapid firings. Again, you know, slow is always good. Slower is always better in pottery. You can't hurt anything by going too slowly. And we'll discuss this later when we talk more about kilns and firing. But when you fire to a particular cone, the faster you fire to that cone, the higher the actual final temperature will be. Weird, huh? But that's the way it is. And we'll talk more about that. So it's very, and glazes can respond to relatively small changes in temperature. 20 degrees difference can be a lot to a glaze in terms of being just properly fired or overfired. And that's within the range that can be affected by how quickly you actually fire the kiln. So I guess in conclusion, I guess I'd like to repeat just a couple of comments that I made at the beginning of this of the series on this topic, is the fact that, first of all, do preliminary tests. If you're not familiar with all the way, the sort of peculiarities of a glaze, do some tests on some pieces that are less important to you than your best piece that you've been saving to do. And take your time. You'll find that the glazing will actually be more enjoyable because you'll get better results if you take your time, and then you'll enjoy the whole process better. So we hope this information has been useful to you. If you'd like to support our educational outreach efforts, you can go to patreon.com and look up the Potter's Roundtable. Also, check out our website, www.hfclay.com. Thank you very much for visiting with us today.
The Potter's Roundtable is brought to you by Washington Street Studios and our patrons. If you enjoy the show, please subscribe, give us a 5-star review, and tell your friends. If you want to learn more about Washington Street Studios and shared studio memberships, please visit our website at www.hfclay.com. Thank you, and we'll see you again next time on the Potter's Roundtable.